Ahuja. She's the academic secretary of Delhi Gynae Forum and the organizing person for this CME. Dr. Meenakshi.
Hi, I hope I'm audible. Like I said, I'm in Goa now and I've actually come directly from the airport to a place where I can try to get some Wi-Fi. And that's why I think I was missing a bit of Dr. Malvika's presentation. And but then I saw it on my phone because thankfully 4G was working. So I think we'll just start the panel. Dr. Kiranjit and I will be sharing the slides and discussing, taking this panel up together. And I'm very thankful to Kiran because she's made a beautiful... Kiran, can we make it full screen, please?
Yeah, I've done that. She's made
a beautiful presentation. I think this, the idea of just going through the ages with every woman we had planned, that except for adolescents, of course, because Nina has taken that beautifully. We will be discussing endometriosis because I think we all keep on needing discussions. We are all dealing with endometriosis and every day we learn something new. And I think if there is even a new thing that we learn in any CME, it's definitely worth it. So I have a very, very esteemed panel with me here today from all the various branches of the Delhi Gynae Forum. Can I have the next slide, Kiran? So the good thing is that we are here, we are sharing experiences of different doctors. I think Dr. Jyoti Malik and Dr. Nymphia are doing IVF also. Dr. Raj Bukharia and Dr. Sonia Naik, who are very well-known laparoscopic surgeons. I have with me Dr. Jyoti Agarwal, who works as an obstetrician, and I think she has a very good experience in gynae ultrasounds. And of course, we have a specialist ultrasonologist with us today, Dr. Glossy Sabarwal. Also with me, Dr. Seema Sehgal and Dr. Sushma Sinha, who are going to take up the cases in which we are going to be discussing management of women as we all are, like basic obstetricians and gynecologists. So without much ado, welcome to all my panel, and I think we'll take the first case scenario. So this is a 21-year-old unmarried girl. Like I said, we are not covering adolescence, but we will follow this girl for the rest of her reproductive years. A 21-year-old unmarried girl presents to the OPD with pelvic pain since 6 to 8 months. Initially, the pain was only during the first 2 days of her period, but now the pain is constant and the severity has increased. Regular cycles, 4 to 5 days every 28 to 30 days. Next slide. So this question goes for Dr. Seema Sehgal. How would you evaluate her clinically and what is your probable diagnosis? Kiran, the previous slide so that the question is visible. So this is for Dr. Seema Sehgal. She's an unmarried 21-year-old presenting to the OPD with pelvic pain. How would you like to clinically evaluate her?
Hi, thank you, Dr. Meenakshi and Dr. Kiran for inviting me. To me, that unmarried girl clinically evaluation is little difficult. Only we are basically looking after her history part more deeply, as Dr. Nina has very clearly mentioned, the type of pain, severity, cyclicity, and the relation with the menstrual periods. So that guide us toward the type of dysmenorrhea. And my probable diagnosis is dysmenorrhea, maybe because of endometriosis, or fibroids, or teomasis, or ovarian cyst of any type. So we have to evaluate basically on the basis of ultrasound only, because we can't do internal examination, and at the most we can do PR.
Examination would like to do. Yeah, okay. So I agree with you that at least when a young woman comes with pain, we should not dismiss saying that they are just the normal feature of a reproductive cycle, that she's having painful periods. We should investigate for sure. But before we investigate, we have to think endometriosis and probably just ask a few things in our history that we can cover. Kiran, the next slide. We have to see that endometriosis may be ovarian, peritoneal, or deep infiltrating. And these lesions, endometriosis and stoma. I don't know kaun lipstick laga raha tha, but I think wo mute kar sakte apne aapko. I don't know who it was. So along with the nerves, blood vessels, and inflammatory cells, and therefore contribute to a variety of symptoms depending on the organs involved. So we all know that the gynecological symptoms could be dyspareunia, chronic pelvic pain, deep dyspareunia, cyclical intestinal complaints, infertility in a married woman, fatigue, heavy menstrual bleeding and postcoital bleeding. And there could be non-gynecological symptoms like dyschezia, dysuria, hematuria, rectal bleeding, shoulder pain and epistaxis or cyclical hemostasis or umbilical hemothorax or umbilical bleeding, which are rare things which are seen. The next slide. On the examination, definitely do a per abdomen to look for any mass. Per speculum, if she is sexually active, so do ask a 21-year-old. In these days, I don't think there is any harm asking her if she's sexually active. And then with a special emphasis on the visualization of the deep endometriosis in the vagina by inspection of the posterior fornix of the vaginal wall. A per rectum in adolescents can be done. A vaginal examination can facilitate the detection of infiltration or nodules in the vagina, or uterosacral ligaments or pouch of Douglas. And a rectovaginal single finger digital examination may allow the detection of infiltration or mass involving the rectosigmoidal colon, adnexal masses, or the sliding sign. We are all aware, like Dr. Seema said, that there is always a delay in diagnosis because women may delay seeking help because of a perception that pelvic pain is normal. And as healthcare professionals, we also do not recognize the importance of symptoms or consider endometriosis a possibility. So we have to remember that endometriosis can be suspected without a surgical exploration. And till the time we don't think endometriosis, we cannot diagnose endometriosis. So Dr. Jyoti Agarwal, what investigation would you like to order for her to support your diagnosis?
I think I shall go to see for the or any masses there, and that will definitely help us to come to a diagnosis. She being unmarried, if she's sexually active, yes, we can in fact to keep a PID also in our mind along with endometriosis.
So what investigations would you like to do?
Basically, ultrasound to help the diagnosis, but we can also take the opportunity of doing the basic blood test now that she has come to a clinic to get a complete blood count done, LFT, SGOT, PT, and creatinine. That is not for the diagnosis, but just to take an opportunity that she has come to the clinic, so we should have a basic idea about her.
And what are the ultrasounds that you have in mind?
Ultrasound, simple 2D is more than sufficient. In case there is any doubt, today we have 3D, 4D also, and that's it. And transrectal, if she is not sexually active, transrectal ultrasound has a very good sensitivity and specificity to diagnose endometriomas almost to the tune of 90% plus. So we can go and do a transrectal also. And in case ultrasound is not helpful, we finally do an MRI for her. But MRI, I am not...
Okay, so only the...
Yes, please.
Yeah. So MRI, you are not advocating as the first line of diagnosis. So
ultrasound, simple 2D ultrasound is more than sufficient. In case it is not very informative, then we can do a 3D also. Or a transrectal ultrasound in an unmarried, that is equally good.
Dr. Kiran, the next slide. The next one. The next one again. An investigative tool in the workup of women with potential underlying endometriosis if they are sexually active. And in women who in whom TVS cannot be done, ultrasound lower abdomen and the transrectal ultrasound can be done. The MRI can be done for deep infiltrating endometriosis. It really does not help us with the peritoneal endometriosis. So just to see the extent of the disease, definitely in a deep infiltrating endometriosis, probably that's the only place where MRI has a role. The next question is for Dr. Glossy Sabarwal. Dr. Jyoti wanted to add something.
I just wanted to add that MRI is better in case we have to offer a CT has no role in diagnosis. MRI is better.
So, Dr. Glossy, as a radiologist,
Meenakshi, can I interrupt? Meenakshi, can I interrupt?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, Anna, but yes, I thought then you know things get hard. So when you are ordering it PVS, right, and when you are suspecting deep infiltrating endometriosis, it is very important that you do bowel preparation and then you do a TVS. Otherwise, you will miss out on the deep infiltrating endometriosis. Okay?
Right, ma'am.
I think that's a very, very important point that you brought up, ma'am. And that's why we have experts here with us to guide us in these questions. So the next question for Dr. Glossy. So a patient comes and, you know, as the gynecologist has said that she is suspecting endometriosis. So from a regular TVS or a transabdominal, what are the other points you would like to look at? And what are the sonographic evaluation of women with suspected or known endometriosis by the IDEA group?
Thank you, Dr. so Glossy. Thank you. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you so much, Delhi Gynae Forum. It's an honor to be part of the prestigious organization. And thank you, Meenakshi ma'am, for trusting me for this wonderful opportunity. So most of the things have been very well explained by Dr. Jyoti ma'am, by Dr. Neena ma'am, that when we are talking about evaluation of a patient with suspected endometriosis, ultrasound will remain the first and the foremost imaging modality. When we say ultrasound, we broadly talk about transabdominal ultrasound, transvaginal ultrasound, and transrectal ultrasound. Now, our first choice, according to the International Deep Endometriosis Analysis Group, is that we go for a transvaginal ultrasound. Is that is not possible when we go for a transrectal ultrasound. Per abdomen, to assess the rectosigmoid part on ultrasound becomes very difficult because the bowel is going to come in between and it will be tough for us. Whenever any air comes, the ultrasound waves or sound waves, they can't penetrate and you will miss on the things. Then MRI comes into the picture that we are not able to do transvaginal, we are not able to do TRUST, so we go in for an MRI. Second thing which is important is that before starting the scan, there has to be little fluid in the bladder because the bladder will give us an acoustic window to see the lesions very clearly when we are doing the transvaginal scan. Just a little pressure, not over distended bladder. And bowel preparation, as Jyoti ma'am very nicely mentioned, that we have to have a bowel preparation for the patients to delineate the deep endometriotic lesion. Now, IDEA group proposes 4 very simple steps to complete your evaluation for endometriosis, known case or suspected case. So first is step 1. You don't have to go through like 1, 2, 3, 4. The order can be any, but these 4 steps must be done in every patient suspected or known case. So first is that we evaluate exactly. These are the 4 steps. So first is that we evaluate the uterus, ovaries, adnexa. Now, what do we see in the uterus? We look for adenomyosis. Then we talk about the ovaries. What do we look in the ovaries? We look for endometriomas. What is the type of endometrioma? Is it a typical endometrioma giving ground glass appearance of a chocolate cyst, or it has got some papilla in it? If there is a papilla, then
It is basically more in cases of IVF that we are using GnRH agonists when we have to do down regulation, but otherwise we can both have a similar mode of action as far as we are concerned in our cases of IVF. In fact, in cases where we have the endometriosis, mild and moderate endometriosis, we are not using agonists there, and that is the only place where we in moderate to severe endometriosis or in cases of IVF, we do propose using GnRH agonists.
What about letrozole?
Yeah, so letrozole, this is an aromatase inhibitor. And they are actually more of use in cases where we are using it in cases of elderly women, like more postmenopausal women, because it is inhibiting the extra ovarian synthesis of estrogens. So letrozole is a very good drug, and the quality of life that it improves, the pain levels that it reduces, it has been found to be very, very useful. And especially in cases where we are using, infertility patients, rather than clomiphene, it is always preferable in cases of infertility with minimal to mild endometriosis to use a letrozole there in case to induce ovulation. And here also we have to be very careful about the the bone fractures that it can cause, the osteoporosis part. So anything more than 6 months should be taken with a lot of care, and we have to always, we can use it with progestins in case we are using it for endometriosis.
And cabergolin?
Yes, cabergolin is something, it is an angiogenic, anti-angiogenic medicine. And by angiogenic mode of action, and it is it inhibits the angiogenesis, and 0.5 mg twice a week for 3 months. It is very effective, though practically I have not used it much, but definitely studies do recommend the role of cabergolin in cases of endometriosis, and it has as good a role as a GnRH agonist, and the size of endometrioma also it reduces. So these are the newer drugs that we have. So in cases if a patient has a side effect to one particular drug, we have a basket of different options where we can use these.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti. Can we go to the next case, Dr. Kiran?
Okay, so I take over. So now this girl, now she is 28 years of age and she's been married for 3 years. She used barrier method of contraception for 6 months initially, and now she's been trying to conceive since 2.5 years. She used Dynogest, you prescribed her 2 years back for 2 years. Symptomatic.
So I'll give.
Mute yourself. Yeah. So now she has regular cycles, but with dysmenorrhea. And on the ultrasound scan, TVA scan, there's a right endometriotic cyst, 5 cm, and the AMH is 3.2 nanogram per ml, and male factor is normal. So my question is to Dr. Raj Bukharia. Ma'am, how will you manage this patient? Dr. Raj, you need to unmute.
I am unmuted myself.
Ma'am, yes, now we can hear you. We can't see you. Yes. Ma'am, we can't hear you. You need to unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am.
C is a known case of endometriosis. Correct. And yes. Now she has reached to 28 years of age.
Yes, ma'am.
With her married life for 3 years, where she has used barrier method for initial 6 months, and now she is trying for the fertility for last 2.5 years. Right. So now she has become a case of endometriosis with infertility. Her right. male factor is normal. Her AMH is normal. But we don't know about her tubal status, first thing. And the second thing, now the prognostic factor in this infertility associated with endometriosis is her age, duration of infertility, good AMH, and she must be having a good AFC count also. So now I will counsel her. Now regarding the treatment, what you are saying, the medical treatment has no place in endometriosis associated with infertility. Now, the other thing is the ovulation induction. And with the IUI or with the IVF, now I will ask her in the last 2.5 years, what treatment plan she has undergone. whether she has undergone the ovulation induction or not. If not, I will now use the role of the counseling. Because whether what she wants, she is young, endometrioma, presence of endometrioma as such doesn't indicate that she should only be taken for the surgical treatment. Now, if she has ovulation induction with IUI, either the induction done with lactose or gonadotropin, but I'll counsel her also that the success rate are not very high. And if she leaves the opinion to me, I will take her up for the laparoscopic surgery, because the reason behind is ki we don't know the status of two. We don't know the she is an infertility patient, and I'll counsel ki the success rate after the surgery are maximum in the tune of almost 50 years. And during the counseling, I will also advise her to go for a concomitant laparoscopy and hysteroscopy evaluation along with the tubal status to be adjusted by the chromoperturbation and an endometrial sampling to rule out the tuberculosis.
Right.
Before, with the surgery, because in our India, the association of endometriosis with tuberculosis is also very high.
Right, ma'am. Right. So to summarize, in since she has an endometrioma, which puts her into a category of stage 3 endometriosis.
Yes.
So one, with her condition, she's young. She has short duration of infertility, less than 3 years. She has yes. infertility factors, no other factors. Then she has a good ovarian reserve and no previous surgery is done. So we would prefer doing a laparoscopy, as ma'am explained. And so for her case, ovarian stimulation is not an option, and ovarian stimulation with IUI is not the first line option, as ma'am explained. So we choose to do a laparoscopy followed by an expectant management or followed by an IVF after discussion. And there is no role for medical management in the endometriosis with infertility. So ma'am, next question is, after a discussion with the patient, you decided to do a laparoscopy for her. How will you proceed for laparoscopy in endometriosis-associated infertility? And what are the points one needs to keep in mind during laparoscopic cystectomy, as she has an ovarian cyst there, endometriotic cyst?
So now, the counseling part is very important in this case before we take her up for the surgery. Now, the counseling has to be very essential regarding the ovarian reserve, which is going to be a little low once we do the surgery. So that she has to be well informed before the surgery. And we will be doing the AMH again after the surgery. And she has to be given and counseled regarding the risk of the premature ovarian failure. She is in a moderate endometriosis of grade 3. So, and that also a progress of the disease in last 5 to 7 years, in 5 years when she is off the treatment. And it has increased, the endometrioma on the same side has increased from the 2.8 centimeter to 5 centimeter. So the chances of the extensive disease, it can be a pelvic and peritoneal endometriosis can be also associated. That all has to be counseled. Now the second counseling part is the relative risk of recurrence. That also she has to be done, even in spite of doing a complete surgery. She has to be told that this is the first and the only surgery in her lifetime for endometriosis.
Right.
The third thing is ki there are chances of incomplete surgery in this case if there is an involvement of the deep infiltrating endometriosis.
So there are
The peritoneal endometriosis. If the lesions are very near to the vital organ, we have to leave a residual disease rather than injuring to the vital organ. So all these has to be explained to be her beforehand. And the other thing which she has to understand, ki there is a risk of malignancy always. Even though a very, very remote chances in this case, but that has to be also told beforehand. And last but not least, the endometriosis infertility index score to predict her chances and success in the fertility after the surgery, all has to be discussed before. Now, the second question regarding the steps of the surgery, I think Dr. Malvika has already shown so many slides associated with or without the infertility, how the endometriotic surgery is a complex surgery. It needs a level 3 type or 4 type of the experience in doing the endoscopic surgery. Always the endoscopic surgery is the best in this endometrioma. And now the object of the endometriotic cyst surgery will be, as mentioned earlier by the previous speaker, to reduce the risk recurrence rate, to improve her symptoms, like the infertility, restore the normal pelvic anatomy, also the chances of doing a complete surgery at one go only. Right. Now, once we decide to go for the surgery, the preoperative preparation is also equally important, as we are thinking she is in a case of the third stage endometriosis. We have to involve the multidisciplinary team also in case if we need, if the lesions, we find the peritoneal lesions near to the vital organ like the bladder or the rectum or the ureter. The third thing is the position of the patient. This surgery is maybe going to take much time. So a sequential compression device to prevent the deep vein thrombosis, the precaution has to be taken during the surgery due to the position and the prolonged duration of the surgery. Now, once consent, it comes a very important role, especially in our this medico-legal period. The consent has to be the procedure specific, and a detailed consent has to be taken, telling about all the risk and benefit, the complication, the success rate of the surgery. Now, once we have prepared now the surgery, we take her up for the surgery. Now, once we put the scope, it has to be a multiple lateral port. Whether it is a 2 or 3 ancillary port is a must. You can't do the endometriotic surgery with 1 or 2 port only, with 1 port only. Now, once you put the scope in, you are going to do a systemic complete evaluation of the pelvis, including the upper abdomen going up to the diaphragm, and also looking from one side in a clockwise manner so that we don't leave any part from the uterus, adnexa, the vaginouterine pouch, the pouch of Douglas, the right adnexa, the left adnexa, all the pelvic sidewall. And that has been already shown by Dr. Malvika initially in her beautiful videos. Now, once we have done, I will also like to do the per speculum examination again in the laparoscopy, when the patient is taken for the laparoscopy, because in the light of the laparoscope, we can visualize sometimes the subtle endometriotic implants in the vagina or in the cervix also. Now, once we start now, after the evaluation, we have to do the adhesiolysis. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
We
can hear you.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I can't hear any. I can just see your face.
We can hear you.
We can hear.
Huh? We can hear.
I have...
So would just like to add on to what Dr. Raj Pukharia was telling us till the time she joins back. You know, sometimes you encounter endometriosis at the time of diagnostic laparoscopy when you're doing it for infertility. So the dictum is that you should see and treat. If you find endometriosis that time, you have to treat it. You can't just do an in and out diagnostic laparoscopy. So hence, the consent here is very important, and a preparation for diagnostic laparoscopy should be adequately done. And as ma'am said, that one has to do a careful and a stepwise exploration of the whole abdomen, starting from uterus and adnexa to tubo-ovarian relation to the ovarian fossa to the POD, pararectal spaces, rectum, sigmoid, appendix, and up till the diaphragm.
Now you can hear me, Kiran?
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you.
So yes, yes.
Now we start doing the digitalysis, mm-hmm. and it is preferred rather than doing ablation, the excision of the adhesions or the peritoneal implant has to be done. We have to restore the, try to restore the normal pelvic anatomy and maintaining the ovarian femoral relationship. And we make the adenexa free. Now we come to the endometrioma. Now we have to be very careful in doing the endometriotic cystectomy, which is always preferred and already emphasized by our previous speakers. Now we have to drain the, usually when we are doing the adhesiolysis and lifting up the ovary from the bed, the endometrioma usually rupture. And when you see the punctum, you have to do the proper suction and irrigation to clear all the endometriotic chocolate fluid. And then we have to extend the incision, do a cystoscopy to rule out any papillation or the solid nodule into the cyst wall. Then is the next step is the look for the and find out the proper cleavage and plane for the to hold the cyst wall and do the cystectomy by doing the a gentle stripping of the cyst wall by using your traction and counter traction. And once near the base, we may find some bleeding again start. We can take use of the hydrodissection and the use of pitressin also to reduce the bleeding during the surgery. Now, once we reach near to the bed, sometimes the bleeders comes out because of the feeding blood vessels at the base of the endometriosis. We have to see if we don't damage the ovarian cortex. We have to away from the hilum of the ovary also. And once the cystectomy is done, if it is very large, we have to put always into the, retrieve the sample in endo bag. Otherwise, a small cyst, like in this case, we can take out from the bigger port of 10 to 12 centimeter, 12 to 12 millimeter. Now, once we have to see, achieve the complete hemostasis, the question of doing the suturing and is usually not done, but it is the choice. It is said that the suturing can reduce the, it is better than doing the electrocoagulation and to preserve the follicle, the number of the follicle. Now the next is when we are doing, we have to, once the complete hemostasis is achieved, we have to, we can use the adhesion barrier and it really prevents the adhesion formation in future. And always send the biopsy for the biopsy, the endometriotic cysts all to prove and to rule out the malignancy.
Right, right. Ma'am, you
next question is what?
Ma'am, you've covered the surgical part beautifully.
There was another question.
Ma'am, cystectomy. It was related to cystectomy only.
Achy.
Right. Thank you, ma'am. She's covered all the points regarding the surgery very nicely. Let's move on to our next question. Now, the same lady comes post-surgery. This is for Dr. Nymphia. Is there a role of hormonal therapy as an adjunct to surgery for treatment of infertility? Is there a role of IUI in this patient? And are the pregnancy rates different in IVF for endometriosis and IVF for other etiologies?
Okay, good evening, everyone. First of all, thank you for having me, but I'll quickly come to the answer. Yeah. Okay, so it is well written in all the guidelines that there is no role of hormonal therapy, especially after an immediate surgery, because that is the golden period for the girl to conceive. If we are giving her medical therapy, we'll be delaying her pregnancy. Yeah. Number two, if we have done the surgery and we have seen the fallopian tubes are good and she has no history of any infertility treatment in the past, then we can offer her one or two cycles of IUI because she was a patient with a good ovarian reserve, and then move on to an IVF. We can counsel the patient. At times it's a over the table discussion between the clinician and the patient according to the circumstances and what the patient wants. So there is no harm in offering one or two cycles of IUI. So if at all the patients land, this patient lands up in an IVF, So there was a time when it was believed that the pregnancy rates for IVF and endometriosis are lesser as compared to other causes of infertility, but that is not now the case. It was realized in all the studies that there were some other confounding factor or some other infertility factor associated. So in the minority of women who will have just endometriosis as a cause of infertility, the IVF outcomes would be similar because of the protocols which we follow now.
Right. So to summarize, adjunct medical therapy is not recommended before or after surgery to improve the spontaneous pregnancy rates. Controlled ovarian hyperstimulation with IUI does not change the chance of conception after operated stage 3 endometriosis, because like this patient has endometrioma, which puts her into a category of grade 3. And usually you see a tuber ovarian relationship is hampered with an endometrioma. So only in cases where the tubes are patent, you may give a cycle of one or two cycles of IUI, as Dr. Nymphia rightly said. So regarding the IVF in endometriosis versus IVF in other etiologies, the pregnancy rates for women with stage 3 and 4have significantly lower than the for IVF done for tubal factors. So coming to our next question, Dr. Nymphia, how will you counsel this patient and what stimulation protocol you'll give? Can previous surgery affect the ART cycle? And in which patients would you like to do down regulation?
Okay. So basically, I'll be counseling the patient that first of all, I'll try to recheck the ovarian reserve because she has already undergone a surgery. And let us see what we have lost in doing the ovarian cystectomy. And the ideal stimulation protocol in her case would be an antagonist protocol, because what we now like to do is that there was a time when we used to give long-acting GnRH analogs for 2 to 3 cycles and then give stimulations. But now we like to do an antagonist protocol, take out the eggs, make the embryos, then down-regulate and then do a frozen embryo transfer. That is the ideal thing to do. And of course, as I said, we'll be counseling because the previous surgery will be affecting the ART cycle, as there will be some loss of healthy ovarian tissue along with. So I would like to repeat an AMH level for prognostication purposes. And the third question was...
it was for down regulation. So do you do down regulation for all the
endometriosis? No. Generally, okay. Mostly it is individual based. If it is a grade 3, stage 3, 4 endometriosis, just showing an endometrioma, I will believe there will be some element of an maybe mild adenomyoma also, and I would like to suppress it before the transfer. Besides that, there was also a theory regarding some form of endometrial peristalsis associated with active endometriosis. That is also suppressed if we are giving long-acting GnRH analogs before the transfer. So keeping these two things in mind, I would definitely like to down-regulate before a embryo transfer.
How about IVF and ICSI? What would you prefer in this? Is there any difference?
No. That will entirely depend upon her reserve, what quality of eggs we are getting, what is the semen count, not per se. That I'll leave on my embryologist to decide. But in most of the cases, in these days, we hardly leave any patient for an entire IVF cycle. We do ICSI for at least some cohort of oocytes, and if the cohort is very good, then we keep some for IVF.
Right. So to summarize, a woman with minimal to mild endometriosis and endometrioma showed that implantation rate and clinical pregnancy rates after controlled ovarian stimulation with GnRH antagonist were not inferior to those for GnRH agonist protocols. And women with stage 3 or 4 endometriosis, the clinical pregnancy rate per cycle was found to be significantly higher in the ultra-long protocol groups compared to the long protocol groups. And the previous ovarian surgery results in longer stimulation, higher FSH requirement, decreased oocyte number, but no difference in fertilization pregnancy outcome in subsequent ART cycles. So as Dr. Nymphia said, hormonal treatment for suppression of ovarian function in these patients to improve fertility is no longer being used. And IVF and ICSI give the similar results for these patients. Fresh embryo transfer is done if there is no adenomyosis, and frozen embryo transfer after Down regulation over 2 to 3 months if significant adenomyosis is there. So coming to our next case scenario.
I would, sorry to interrupt. Dr. Ganjit, I would have to leave. Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Meenakshi. Thank you for having me. I have to leave for another meeting. Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay.
Coming to our next case scenario, a 36-year-old lady, she is...
Kiran, I will also leave now. Right? I have another webinar.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for joining us, ma'am. Dr. Jyoti Malik, a 36-year-old lady, she is para zero. She's had one MTP done 6 years back. She's been married for 4 years now and unable to conceive. She has regular cycles, normal flow, no pain. She's had 2 cycles of IUI, which were unsuccessful about 6 months back. The male factor is normal. Her AMH is 0.9 and the ultrasound shows endometriotic cyst 4 centimeters in left ovary, adherent ovaries, and uterus is normal, so which is suggestive of grade 4 endometriosis. How will you manage her?
Yeah, Dr. Kiran, this is a very, very difficult case because she is already 36. She has big endometrioma. She is, I think one side is 4 centimeters and the other is also grade 4. And her AMH is very low. So this is a case actually where I don't have any time to waste. And I cannot try anything like IUI or anything. The only thing I have in hand is as early as IVF as early as possible. And since she now, whether I do a surgery before doing IVF, either we take these women for IVF, because by doing surgery, we are anyhow removing that whatever bit of good follicles are there, they may also by doing surgery levels. Right. So the place where a surgery would be when if clinically I feel that the endometrioma is coming in my way of doing the pickup, in my pickup needle if it is coming, that is the only point I would like to do a surgery. Because as it is, she has very big, both sides she has big endometrioma.
That's my next question to you. What factors would determine that you need to do a surgery, versus drainage or removal prior to IVF? And surgery be performed prior to IVF to improve the reproductive outcome?
Yeah. So the only thing where I would like to do a surgery, and that too also, I mean, you want a cyst drainage. I think it should be a cystectomy rather than a cyst drainage. I would always prefer doing a cystectomy. Cyst drainage is something where there is always a chance of refill and it will recur very, very soon if we just do a drainage. But if we don't have, I mean, just prior to doing IVF, the only point where it should be done is when it is coming in my way of pickup. And or otherwise, if suppose it is distorting the uterine, sort of, if I have a difficulty during embryo transfer, if it is distorting my, if it has caused a recurrent IVF failures, if she has undergone before, then I would like to do a surgery for her. And the only other two indications of doing a surgery is if we are suspecting a malignancy or if there is a severe pain. So these are the two things, plus during, if we are doing a pickup and we have a problem there, these are the three things where I feel surgery should be done. And considering the age, if the age is more, I would not like to do a surgery. Bring her ovarian reserve, and we always have to counsel the woman and and see. Now surgery prior to IVF, that whether we should be doing or not. Now there are studies where they say that there is even the latest, there was a study in obstetric gynecology in 2019 where they said that could surgical management improve the outcomes, and in this review they are saying that by doing a surgery we are further reducing the ovarian reserve in these patients. where the ovarian reserve has already been less because of the endometrioma. So that was that one paper here, and the other that you are quoting here is the GDD recommendations, where they say that clinicians should consider cystectomy prior to ART to improve the pain only or the accessibility of the follicles during removal. Now, if it is a larger than 3 centimeter, there is no evidence that doing a cystectomy would improve our IVF success rates. So I don't recommend doing a surgery prior to that. And only in cases of deep nodule, the effectivity in deep nodular lesions before this also is not well established. I would not do just for deep nodular lesions. If we are doing a surgery, if it is the first surgery where there is a DIE, that particular time we do the maximum excision even for those deep seated lesions. But as per se, definitely by removing those lesions, we are improving our outcomes, but not otherwise. Just because we see them and we are taking them for IVF, I would not recommend doing that.
So for this patient, we'll go in for an IVF straight away.
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti. Dr. Meenakshi, you can take over. We can't hear you. Can't hear you. Okay, so I'll take that question. This is for Dr. Jyoti Agarwal.
Yeah, that's right.
Right. So Dr. Jyoti, this patient is 38-year-old, para 2 life 2, with last childbirth 8 years back, and she's had one previous cesarean. She complains of severe dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia since 6 months. Her cycles are regular but heavy. She's hypertensive on treatment. Her ultrasound TVS shows endometriotic cyst, which is 3 centimeters, and her uterus is adenomyotic. What management option will you offer her?
This lady has completed her family and she has endometriosis. She's hypertensive. I think I'll straight away offer her with the LNG IUS, that is Mirena.
Right.
That would be my treatment. In case she doesn't accept or she's not able to tolerate, then I can offer her GnRH agonist or dynogest. But my first choice will be Mirena for her.
So what about surgery?
No need. Endometriosis is just 3 centimeters. Mirena will take care of her symptoms. Basically, you have to deal with the dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia, which is bothering her the most.
Right. Dr. Meenakshi, you want to take? Okay, we can't hear her. So LNG IUS is an effective treatment in reducing endometriosis associated pain and heavy menstrual bleeding. So, and it gives a higher patient satisfaction. So this patient is ideal for a LNG IUS.
Absolutely.
Dynogest, although, is an option, right? So coming to the next case scenario, Dr. Sonia, are you there? Dr. Sonia Naik, I can't see you.
I'm there, Kiran.
Okay, good. So this is for you. You've been waiting long for a question, I guess. Okay.
Yeah,
this lady is 44-year-old and she's para 1, live 1 with the last childbirth 14 years back, which was a cesarean. She complains of severe pelvic pain, dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia. She's had 2 surgeries for endometriotic cyst in the past. She has taken multiple treatments, including Dynogest, GnRH. She's even tried LNG IUS, which got expelled, but nothing has given her complete relief. Now her ultrasound, she's come to you and her ultrasound shows endometrioma of 5 centimeters in right ovary, 3 and 2 centimeters in left ovary. Bilateral ovaries are adherent to the uterus and uterus is adenomyotic. So how will you counsel this patient and what management will you offer her?
Okay, so thank you for moderating the session so well, both of you, Dr. Meenakshi and Dr. Kiranji. And so over here, if we consider she's already 44 years, she's had various sorts of medical management options taken, and she's had 2 surgeries also done for her. and she's still suffering from all the agony of endometriosis. And I'm sure she must be waiting to somebody for to relieve her agony. And I think here we'll have to counsel her that quality of life is something which is really important. So something which improves our quality of life. So over here, we'll give her the option of the surgery. Now she has endometriomas in both the ovaries. She has adenomyosis, but she has no menstrual symptoms. Her only complaints are dysmenorrhea and pain. Now, provided because she's, I'm just coming to the next, to the council and the management, both the answers go hand in hand. Now, when we are telling her about the surgery, over here we tell her that we are going to remove both the ovaries. She's 44 years. And if we don't remove both the ovaries, it's just removing the cyst again will not solve a problem. So removing both the ovaries, because we have to stop the estrogen production over here. So we'll have to remove both the ovaries. So her next question is that, what about, because she'll have a surgical menopause. So we'll then answer her the questions that we give her hormone replacement therapy, because she's only 44 years, if she's willing to, because it's not necessary that all women 44 years will be willing to take any menopausal hormonal therapy also. So if in case she's willing to, there are safer options without, which will not cause a recurrence or cause a malignant transformation of the residual deposits or the microscopic deposits. So we'll give her the option of those as well. And but now we're here, the only,
have you planned for her? What surgery would you do for her exactly? What
so surgery? We will do a laparoscopy. So any endometriosis, we should always try a laparoscopic approach, because that gives us the best vision possible. The only thing we have to counsel her, because she's had multiple surgeries, that we might involve the GI surgery team or the urologist, because in case the ureter or the rectum or something else is involved, we'll also have to take care of that part also. So it might be a multi-speciality surgical treatment also over here, that we might have to counsel her about that. Now, regarding preoperative, any GnRH or anything, we don't have to give any of those sorts, but we'll have to give any post-op. We'll definitely have to consider. You haven't mentioned the BMI. Suppose if she's a thin lady, she doesn't have any residual deposits, then we don't have to. I'll talk about that later. Okay. And now, regarding the management part, the removal of uterus is one question that we have to discuss with her. You've written that she has adenomyosis, but she doesn't have any menstrual complaints. Now, if we remove both the ovaries and we don't remove the uterus, probably even that might solve her problem. But again, if the uterus is adherent to the rectum or there is a rectovaginal endometriosis, then we'll take care of that part also. So her treatment might be TLH with BSO, or it might be only the BSO with the preservation of the uterus. So now coming to the the post-surgery medical therapy adjunct. So basically now we're here post-surgery. So now we have operated upon her. The question comes into whether we should actually suppress the microscopic deposits or not. So that we have to, can we directly start the menopausal therapy, or we should delay the menopausal therapy for some time? If we are delaying the menopausal hormonal therapy, should we suppress the microscopic endometriotic deposits or the residual endometriotic deposits? If we have to suppress it, for how long should we suppress it, and what should we use to suppress it? So then we have to suppress it in three scenarios. If the disease is very severe, if she's obese, that means she'll have more production of the estrogens, androgens can be converted into the estrogens. And the third thing is, in case she has residual, we have left some residual disease. So any of these three things, you should give some medical therapy to suppress the microscopic deposits of the endometriosis. So you can either give her GnRH analog, that's a very good choice, or you can give her dinoges for 3 to 6 months, or you can give her a progesterone, depo provera, or you can give her a medroxyprogesterone acetate. Any of these choices can be given to 3 to 6 months, depending upon the disease. Generally, it's given for 3 months. And about the hormone replacement therapy, then you've suppressed it for 3 months. Now you come back to, now she's complaining of menopausal symptoms, and you need to address those symptoms. So definitely you will give her the options of the menopausal hormonal therapy. Now, what are the choices that you have? Considering that you've removed the uterus also, but you still have to give her progesterone with estrogen. You can't give her estrogen in a person who's had a previous history of severe endometriosis or a hysterectomy for endometriosis. So a continuous combined therapy, menopausal hormone therapy will be the best option. The second option that she can have is a tibolone. So a tibolone can be used because it's a selective receptor modulator. So it is estrogenic at some places, estrogenic in the symptom relief and estrogen antagonistic in the tissue, in the tissues, in the endometrium, in the breast. So tibolone is another. The third option that is newly come up is again a SERM with the estrogen, that is the bazidoxifene. So bazidoxifene is very good in preventing osteoporosis. And so it's given in combination with the conjugated estrogen. So bazidoxifene with conjugated estrogen, that's available, this combination is available in India as Ruabi. So that also can be given.
So that, what is the combination called?
Ruabi, D-U-A-W-W-E. So you can either this combination. So combined hormonal therapy is the easiest and the tibolone. But tibolone when you're giving, you just have to be sure that the female has to be less than 60 years. She doesn't have a risk factors for the stroke. So these are the various therapies that you can offer.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Sonia. You've summarized it very well. So I think we come to the end of our panel discussion. Dr. Meenakshi, would you like to say something? All the panelists have been very, very good and to the point. Excellent discussion they have done. We still can't hear you. Dr. Uma Rai, ma'am, would you like to say something?
I think under the valuable leadership of Dr. Sharda Jain, we can see an improvement of the academic quality programs that we've been having, and we've been really doing well. And this program was really great in the sense, I mean, all the DGF zones were involved and all the OBGYN, all from our specialties were involved. That was very good.
Yes, yes. Thank you. I think, let me see if we have any questions. They again want to know the name of the preparation with the bezidoxifen with estrogen.
Duawi. D-U-A-W-E.
It's D-U-W?
D-U-A-W-E.
Duawi. Yeah, Duawi. Right. I think we had one question prior to this also. I think there was a pathologist who had joined in. He wanted to know how much do you rely on pathology of endometriosis for diagnosis and using IHC. Can anybody answer that? I don't think we still rely on any of the histopathological reports for endometriosis. It's only when you have a suspicion that this is having a malignancy.
So in this case, basically, I mean, in perimenopausal endometriosis, when you have, and especially in perimenopausal or postmenopausal endometriosis, a de novo, not that which has recurred or a residual one, but which is a de novo endometriosis in this particular age group, one has surgical option is the first line option because you have to take the tissue for histopathology. And over here, sometimes endometriosis and malignancy, they look very similar even on imaging. And the clear cell carcinomas and endometrioid carcinomas, they are not very uncommon in endometriosis. I mean, we operated upon a case yesterday and we had clear cell carcinoma in one of the very frozen pelvis with very severe endometriosis. So one has to keep these options. And in these cases, IHC is definitely important.
And pathologists are definitely very, very important even in younger age group, adolescent, for the endometrioma.
Yeah, pathologists needed, their reports are very much required.
Very much required. And it's very, very
important.
Much
required.
Yeah, very important.
Dr. Kiranjeet, I think you did a wonderful job, you and Meenakshi. But I must tell you here that you can, Dr. Jyoti Agarwal, Dr. Seema Sehgal, They're all noted in IVF experts. They are not just obstetricians and ultrasonologists. They're great IVF experts, so you underutilize them today.
Ma'am, we had a great discussion. Very well moderated, Dr. Kiran and Dr. Meenakshi.
Very well, very well.
Thank you to all of you.
Thank you so much.
A big thank you to all of you.
So, I congratulate the panelists, Dr. Uma Rai, Dr. Kimani. Dr. Uma Rai is still with us throughout the session. Dr. Shada Jain, Dr. Malvika Sabharwal. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
I think it was a class CME. Class CME. It was very good.
Absolutely very wonderful.
Thank you, Kiran ma'am. Thank you, Meenakshi ma'am. It was an honor. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Kiranjit, it was really nice. Meenakshi, excellent. Beautifully moderated. And the panelists were amazing.
Right.
All of you are so good.
Thank you, ma'am.
You have done a good job, Kiran. Thank you so much.
Too good. No. Thank you so much.
The thing is, you have prepared the slides so well. You have gone extensive and exhaustive preparation.
Yes, I agree, doctor.
Absolutely.